The rocker of a surfboard is the curve that runs from the nose to tail when viewed from side on, which allows the board to roll nose to tail like a rocking chair. I would love to be able to give you a simple metric or equation to describe different rockers, but unfortunately, because they are compound curves, the only way to do it is by measuring up from the floor at intervals to get a rough idea. Until recently, surfboard outlines and rocker templates were mostly compared by eye and experience, which made it challenging for us civilians to develop a confident opinion. Luckily, many boards are now designed with computers that can allow us to compare rocker profiles, helping to increase our understanding and refinement of their design. Like much of surfboard design, we can understand the basic effects of increasing or decreasing the rocker on a board by looking at the same sliding scale we spoke about in previous episodes, with speed at one end and maneuverability at the other, as it's these two attributes that will be most affected, with flatter boards generally being faster and banana-shaped boards having better maneuverability. A surfboard's rocker is generally described in terms of its nose rocker and tail rocker, sometimes called entry and exit rockers, depending on who you talk to. In some designs, these two curves join in the middle in what's called a continuous rocker, while in others they flatten out to create a straight region in the middle of the board, often referred to as a staged rocker. With that in mind, and much like the last two videos, we're going to split the board in half and talk about the front and back halves of the board separately, though both will be contained within this one video. So let's start with entry rocker and the front half of the surfboard. If we were to compare two surfboards with otherwise identical dimensions, though one with entry rocker and one without, it might become somewhat easier to predict where and why the entry rocker might improve the board's performance. If taking off on steeper waves jumps to mind, then you're right, but we're going to start earlier in the surfing process with paddling and catching a wave. When at paddling speed, a surfboard has to push the water aside like a ship, and this creates a bow wave. The steeper the curve of the entry rocker, the greater the bow wave as we paddle and push through the water, since the water is less able to escape over the nose or around the board following the nose outline. To get the board up onto the plane, a vessel needs to ride up over its own bow wave, so boards with more rocker and greater bow waves require more energy to achieve this. And we will have to compensate for these disadvantages by paddling stronger or taking off on a steeper wave to find that extra needed energy. When taking off on a steeper wave, however, we can see that the greater rocker template matches more so the curve of the wave. This becomes most important when reaching the bottom section of the face, where the wave transitions into flat water. This means that less weight on the tail is required to maintain the nose above water, whilst dropping down the wave face. So although we are at a paddle speed disadvantage, we now have a maneuverable advantage when dropping down the wave face on a steeper wave. The final part of this pro-con equation for entry rocker is that when up and riding and making trimming or carving turns, the lifted nose from entry rocker reduces the nose or forward rail that will catch during a turn, as the material is simply lifted away from the water, so again increasing the maneuverability. Exit rocker again fits onto our speed and maneuverability sliding scale, but as with the board's outline, it's whilst up and riding where the effects of the back half of the board become apparent. If you are familiar with the stages of a carving turn, like shifting our weight back to lift the nose and disengaging the rails, allowing us to pivot off the fins, then you might be able to imagine why exit rocker helps in this process. Since our intention is to lift the nose and rail out of the water, by increasing the degree of the arc in the rocker, we will allow the nose and rail to lift either sooner or with less energy and weight shift. For the final part of this puzzle, I want you to imagine travelling in trim, parallel with the wave. It's our rail engaged in the wave face that helps us generate speed. And for more on this, check out episodes 1 and 2 if you're curious about the process. So as the water runs up the wave face and hits the underside of our board and rail, the redirected water will follow the curve of the rocker upwards as it exits the board. Since every action is equal and opposite, this means that the tail rocker will suck the tail down into the wave, and the CFD models of surfboards show this low pressure in the tail very clearly. Think of a board with lots of rocker as being similar to always having a few extra pounds of weight on your back foot at all times. So to conclude, the less entry and exit rocker we have, the faster the board can travel. And the more entry and exit rocker we have, the slower, though more maneuverable, the board is. We can assume there is a Goldilocks zone for each individual user. If you are in the whitewater, learning to catch a wave for the first time, then some entry-level longboards have a relatively high amount of entry rocker, helping to reduce the chance of a nosedive, which are more common in the early levels of surfing. In contrast, some highly advanced surfers ride very flat boards with almost no rocker, as a nod to the traditional boards of the 50s and 60s before rocker became prevalent in design. So although we can answer the why and what of entry rocker, there is still a huge amount of variation in personal selection. Often part of that decision is already made for us in store-bought surfboards, and surfboards are often labelled or grouped within a performance board section or a small wave board section, for example. If you're ordering a custom board, however, having an in-depth conversation with the shaper about your local waves and being clear about your level will always provide the shaper with your personal Goldilocks zone. Thanks for watching, and subscribe below.